The thing I find with skeptics is if you never take any action, you never get any results. So no matter what people think, then it's all in the result. And so look, I'm typically looking 10, 20 or 30 years ahead. And sure, there's some ups and downs, but the long trail is that the market's risen, both in the UK and in Australia and most other places around the world. So it's you've got to be in it to win it. So first of all, we don't use the word advise because then we can get sued on that. But apart from that, then the thought process is if you could buy your parents' property for whatever price they paid, how many would you buy? You'd buy hundreds of them. If you could buy your grandparents' property for the same price they paid, you'd have done the same. And so my philosophy is to accumulate as many assets as possible whilst having enough cash that if there's a difference between the rent and the mortgage, you can still afford to pay the bills and you're not forced to sell. And yeah, just stay in the market as long as possible. But if you look at the market trend, it's like that with a couple of ripples. And so do you want to bet against that graph to say it's suddenly the world's going to come to an end? Or do you want to say, well, as long as you can hold on, sure, there's a few little dips and the rest of it, but generally it's risen. Now, there is places around the world that the market's halved. Yeah. But if you generally stick around major capital cities at the median price where there's height limits, so you can't build any more physical property, that's where all the local workers need to live and to work and they earn all the money. Most of those places haven't gone down. You get all these complicated things, all these intelligent people that come on my show, but it comes down to supply and demand. If there's no physical property around and lots of people want it, price goes up. So really my philosophy is just accumulate and hold on for the long term. So I'm not wondering if property is going to rise in the next year or in the next 6 months. I'm thinking in 10 years time, will it make more money? And as long as I can hold on in the meantime, then I think I'll profit. And it's literally as simple as that. So I started at 22, I was an accountant. I didn't know anything about property, I just understood numbers. And now I've done my 20,000 hours or 50,000 hours to be an expert, and I've interviewed probably 400, done 400 shows on TV interviewing experts, and not a lot's actually changed. Sure, I learned a lot more in the last 20 years, but it still comes down to the basics. So when I was 22, I wanted to buy my own home. So I was just brought up with the education for parents, you've got to buy your own home. Rent money's dead money, so buy your own home. I earned £10,000, and so typically you could afford three times your income, so a £30,000 place, which would be the crappiest place in town. But then I've worked out, I didn't want to live in that place because I came from a good background and I wanted a nice house. And so I fell in love with a three-bedroom house. And I worked the numbers out to say a three-bedroom house was cheaper than a one-bedroom unit, because if I rented two rooms out to two friends, that would pay most of the mortgage, because the rents then were like 10 or 12%. And so this was the logic. A one-bedroom unit's expensive, three-bedroom house is free. And so I ended up buying a £100,000 place for £80,000, so I did a good deal on it. And so I made 2 years' salary overnight and lived for free. And then 2 years later, I worked out how to use the equity to get a free Porsche. So I couldn't afford a Porsche on a three-year lease, but I could afford it on a 25-year mortgage. So I had free house, free Porsche, and if I sold it all and paid off the debt, I'd still make a profit. That's the genius I thought. Working hard for a living isn't necessarily the cleverest way to get on in life. If there's a will, there's a way. If you really want to do it, I've met people with no education, no job, they can still get into the market. So in my case, then having those two tenants that could pay the mortgage then made the difference. But if you think about entrepreneurs, I never wanted to be an entrepreneur. So my dad was a doctor, I was an accountant, I was job for life. I couldn't understand entrepreneurs. How could you run a business not knowing money coming in and out? So I think the property investing stuff is easy and a no-brainer because I've got a job. Whereas I couldn't understand people like you that would be in your own business from a young age. But I thought it's a reasonable bet because I've got a regular income. Whereas I guess entrepreneurs, they wouldn't invest in property because they haven't got the regular income, but they're completely happy taking on hiring lots of people and having an office and expenses, not knowing if you've got revenue coming in. And so this is why I think even entrepreneurs need to get into property, because as an entrepreneur, you're betting red or black, either you're going to make a fortune from your company or you're going to make nothing. And my thought is to take money off the table during your journey, to put it into something safe and solid like bricks and mortar or property, because then if the business doesn't work out, then at least you've got something as a backup. So most people go to school, get the education, they invest in their careers, whether it's in a corporate or as an entrepreneur, and they're betting their whole life on it. And if they create some money, then they'll try and turn it into wealth later on. What I did is I turned it upside down. I created wealth from the start. And so I concentrated on building my asset base, not building my career. So my career was a secondary thing. So have you ever played Monopoly? I buy all those little green houses where they're average price properties. They're easy for you to buy when you land on them. They're easy to rent out. I then go and rent the hotel on Mayfair or Park Lane, because in, say, normal language, say in Sydney, say a $5 or $10 million home, not many people can afford the rent on it. The people that can afford the rent on it don't want to rent it because poor people rent. And so the price goes down. Whereas the price on my $1 million Bondi or Coogee units goes up because there's lots of young renters that can't afford to get in the market, so the price goes up. So I roughly get 4 to 5% yield on mine, and I pay 1 or 2% yield on the expensive ones. So effectively the mathematics is, whatever I can afford to buy, I can rent somewhere 3 times more expensive for the same money. So if you wanted to live in, say, if you could afford, say, 2 or 3 million, that will get you an okay home in Sydney, nothing major. But I'd rather have 3 $1 million units, and I could use that rent to then have a $6 or $7 million home.